हेलो एवरीवन, सो आई वेलकम यू इन दिस लेक्चर वेयर वी विल टॉक अबाउट अ वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट ड्रग पैरासीटामोल एंड यू विल सी इफ यू स्टडी फार्माकोलॉजी ड्रग वाइज इट बिकम्स वेरी इजी नॉट फॉर रिवीजन बट आल्सो व्हेन यू सी दोज ड्रग्स इन मार्केट. सो लेट्स बिगिन विद पैरासीटामोल एंड देर इज अ क्वेश्चन एट द एंड विच यू नीड टू आंसर इन द कॉमेंट बॉक्स. सो लेट्स बिगिन एंड इफ यू लाइक द वीडियोज यू कैन सब्सक्राइब फॉर मोर सच. So basically, let's talk about paracetamol. So you know what paracetamol is. We usually take it in headaches or many kind of pains. So basically, it is an analgesic, okay? And in the WHO analgesic ladder, basically there is a ladder, 3-step ladder by WHO, in which the step 1 is by occupied by paracetamol and likely drugs. So it is a good analgesic and it is one of the most commonly used drug worldwide. It is available over the counter for all ages, okay? And it is first line treatment for pain and pyrexia. So this is the basic thing that you need to know about paracetamol. So now let's proceed on how paracetamol acts, okay? So it is not a quite complex pathway, just this. So you need not to get worried, it's quite easy. I hope you remember it from pathology also. So basically this is your arachidonic acid, which is the, you know, source of eicosanoids. So basically arachidonic acid, what happens, it have basically two pathway, Cox pathway and Lox pathway, okay? Right now we are discussing about paracetamol, so we will focus on this thing, Cox pathway, okay? So now Cox, basically what is paracetamol, I will tell you right now. What you need to know is that if any enzyme is inhibited here, so basically whatsoever the product is formed, that will not be formed. And now if the product formed has important role in, you know, pain, inflammation, all those things, so ultimately the product will get reduced and the fever, pain will get reduced. So that is what we need to learn right now, okay? So what you need to know regarding the paracetamol, although it has very wide mechanism of action, certain mechanism are more like serotonergic pathways, we will see mainly prostaglandin. So basically it will inhibit COX, okay? COX will get inhibited, so the production of prostaglandins will decrease. Now it has analgesic and antipyretic property because it inhibits those prostaglandin, but it does not have anti-inflammatory property. Why so? Because usually we see any drug which inhibits such things, it will also lead to decrease in inflammation. But paracetamol does not have such effect. Why? Because two theories are suggested. Basically, paracetamol will inhibit COX without, you know, peroxides. And now if there is presence of peroxides, the ability to inhibit COX will be decreased. So now at the time of inflammation, there is peroxide generated, you know this. So this leads to decrease in the ability to inhibit COX, okay? But in the brain where you take it, say for headache or all those things, so that thing is not present, so it will act as analgesic. The second theory suggests that there is a COX 1 variant called as COX 3 and it is found in dogs, etc. So that COX 1 variant is active in central nervous system and it is not active at injured or inflamed tissue. So obviously it won't get inhibited there. So this suggests that basically paracetamol has to be associated with antipyretic and analgesic and not anti-inflammatory. So this is the reason why you may see that a patient of osteoarthritis is taking PCM, but a patient of rheumatoid arthritis does not take PCM. So this is the basic mechanism of action that you need to know. Detailed pathway shall to be discussed in pathology. So now what is the dose? Okay, now there is a patient, you need to prescribe him for antipyretic drugs. So as a doctor, you must know the dose. So you can give the dose 1 gram up to 4 times a day and there should be duration of 4-hour difference between both of them. And if someone is having renal impairment, why renal impairment? Again, it will, you know, slow down the excretion of drug. So for that 6-hour gap should be there. Now what are the pharmacokinetics? You should proceed drug like this only, okay? You should know the basics, then mechanism of action, dose, now pharmacokinetics. So what you need to know about pharmacokinetics, again a sort of complex pathway? No, very easy. Just have a look. This is your paracetamol drug, okay? It will normally undergo these two pathways of metabolism, glucuronidation, sulfation. Some amount also undergoes another pathway which is CYP mediated. You must be knowing that cytochrome enzyme stuff. So that CYP, suppose CYP2D6, there are many variants. So it will undergo and it will produce your toxic metabolite which is called as NAPQ, okay? Now this is usually, you know, conjugated with glutathione and excreted out. But suppose if there is a deficiency in this or there is over formation of this pathway, then it will lead to its accumulation and now it will react with cells of liver, your kidney, it will lead to formation of free radicals and ultimately toxicity will occur. So now let's go to the language. So what is the language saying? Basically, it is a metabolized in the liver, and we saw that it is metabolized by glucuronidation and sulfation. Is that okay? Those compounds which are glucuronized or sulfated, they are non-toxic and are easily excreted out. Hena, small amount is oxidized via cytochrome system to form NAPQI, which has this full form. You need not to know that. So NAPQ is formed. Okay, this is not good for us. Therefore, I highlighted in red. So under normal condition, it is detoxified. Okay, but when there is insufficient or a glutathione is deficient, so this glutathione is deficient, so this pathway won't occur, it won't get metabolized, and it will all accumulate. So just know the pathway, know the possible mechanisms, and then react accordingly. So now you are done with sort of pharmacokinetics. More we will see in toxicity. Right now, uses, you know that very well, it is a good analgesic. You can give it for headache, mild migraine. Basically, there are many classes of headache. Okay, cluster, tension, and you should know which category of headache it is preferable. But right now, it is okay. Headache, mild migraine, musculoskeletal pain, and dysmenorrhea. It is also first choice for osteoarthritis. Please focus, it is osteoarthritis, not rheumatoid, because that is kind of inflammatory condition, so it won't work there. And it can be used as antipyretics even in children, because there is no chance of Ray syndrome. And I want you to recall that Ray syndrome is associated with which drug? Okay, you can comment below. Now, what is the drug interaction? So drug interaction, you must be knowing, again, all drug interaction in pharmacology are dealt with this metabolism. Now, if you know this CYP enzyme, okay, so some drugs will inhibit it, some drugs will induce it. Those who will induce it will have a different action. Now, those who will induce will lead to formation of this toxic product. So you must be knowing that. So basically, now if we are using enzyme inducing substances, I hope you know the examples. So these enzyme inducing substances or alcohol excess will increase the NAPQI formation, okay, and the risk will increase. Also, basically, when we use paracetamol with oral anticoagulants, it will lead to variation in INR values, okay. That INR values we need to monitor more, you know, focusedly in the patient who we have given paracetamol. So this is what you need to know about drug interaction. Now, the main part which is focused in this video is paracetamol poisoning. This is a very common drug, okay. You must have seen your relatives, you yourself taking this, but you should know that it should not be overtaken. It should not be taken in a month more than 15 days. It can be lead to that overdosing effect. So what is paracetamol poisoning? Now a patient has come to OPD with paracetamol poisoning. How will you see clinical manifestation? Early nausea, vomiting, abdominal pain, liver tenderness, okay, consciousness is not impaired. So this is early feature. If he presents after 12 to 18 hours, this will lead to centrilobular hepatic necrosis and periportal sparing, okay. And as I have told you, it damages the liver cells and the kidney cells, so it can also be accompanied by renal tubular necrosis. So ultimately, what you need to remember is this can lead to hepatic damage and renal damage. Hypoglycemia can also be found, and this can further lead to hypoglycemic coma, okay. And if it is after 2 days, it may lead to jaundice, and at the end there will be fulminant hepatic failure and death. And you will be shocked to know, but paracetamol is a drug which is kind of a indication for liver transplant. So don't think that paracetamol is so commonly available and we are having fever, still we are studying 24 hours a day, 20 hours a day, okay. So you should take care of your health also and manage accordingly. Now, what is the mechanism of toxicity? I think I need not to tell you that. You know that there is a NAPQI and it binds covalently to the protein and it will cause necrosis and all the free radical generation. Now, in the chronic alcoholics, as I have already told, enzyme inducer as well as alcoholics induces that pathway, and once that pathway is induced, it will lead to increased formation of NAPQI. Now, what is the toxic dose? I hope you remember the normal dose. Toxicity will develop at 7.5 to 10 gram per day. Normal was 1 gram. So now you can see there is sort of, you know, means there is a range, but it is still 7.5 to 10 gram per day. Or if you are going by the body weight, then it can be 140 milligram per kg. So it is useful in pediatrics population. If it is greater than 20 gram, it can lead to fatal dose, that is death. Now, what we need to know, treatment. Okay, so patient presented you, if he presented earlier, say nausea, vomiting and that abdominal pain. So basically you can do gastric lavage. Charcoal can also be given. You know, charcoal will prevent the further absorption. But if it is late, charcoal will be not of any use because it has already been absorbed. So now you need to give this specific important reagent, that is your N-acetylcysteine. Now, how it will act again? It will again act by your pathway of this NAPQ. So what it will do? It will replenish your glutathione stores. What will glutathione stores replenishment help? Basically, you again know this pathway. It will lead to the metabolism of NAPQ. And then as it will be prevented, the metabolite won't bind to your cellular constituent and your liver and kidney will be saved. What is the dose which you need to give? Basically, you can remember it as 150 mg per kg. The toxic dose of paracetamol, 140, usse 10 zyada, 150 mg, we give it over 15 minutes and then we continue the same dose over the next 20 hours. So this is all you need to know about paracetamol. So apart from studying it as a part of NSAID, if you study paracetamol exclusively, you can now go to the clinic and you can diagnose what paracetamol toxicity will lead to. So revise with me in a minute. Paracetamol, you know, analgesic, okay? How it will act? It will basically inhibit this pathway, COX, COX1, COX2, okay? What is the dose recommended? 1 gram. Pharmacokinetics, you know, metabolism by this pathway. This pathway major, this will lead to toxic reactions. Ultimately, you need to know drug interaction. It can lead to poisoning. And then ultimately, you need to treat that poisoning. So I hope these things are clear to you. You can also watch my older videos if you like the pattern of teaching. And this is the assessment question. You need to answer it in comments. And these small efforts will help you in learning more because you will remember that I answered this question in comments. So again, keep learning. And I wish that if you like the video, kindly give me the feedback so that we can improve more. Thank you. Stay safe. Stay healthy.